Good morning. Great to see you all in church on the first Sunday of a brand new series. I'm always glad when you're here on the first Sunday because what's going to happen over these next several weeks, I believe God's going to meet with us, God's going to speak to us, God's going to challenge and inspire us, and you're here on the very first day. And so I want to encourage you to be engaged throughout this series. And one of the ways that you can do that is through our message application guide. I just want to tell you, this is a great way and a great time to begin a small group. If you have interest in doing something like that, maybe you've thought about it, but you've never taken a step to do it yet, this could be your opportunity. What you can do is you can either stop by the Welcome Center on your way out, straight outside there in the center section of the lobby. You can pick up a message application guide there, or you can go on our website at gotothepoint.com. You can download a PDF that has questions that allow you to interact around the content of this series. And we put those questions together with the idea that you can maybe meet together one-on-one with a friend over lunch once a week over the next few weeks. You can meet in a conference room or a break room at your work. You could do it at the dinner table one evening a week after we've had a Sunday. You could get together. This is a topic that has a lot to talk about when it comes to living life and living together as families. And there really are principles that are going to be applicable for every person in this room, no matter how young or old you are. So give it consideration. And you know, if you want to get to a group together, it can be just you and another person, or you and your family, or you and a couple of families and some friends, whatever, but it really is a good time to give that consideration. There is no question about it. Over the last few decades, I think, there has been a values vacuum in the United States of America and perhaps even in our world. For years now, we've been in a permissive society where basically anything goes. And as a result, we've been living in that society, and now we are beginning to reap the results. We're beginning to see some of the consequences land all around us. Crime, murder, escalating divorce rates, drug and alcohol abuse, sexual immorality are just a few of the symptoms of the moral decline that we've been seeing in America. Everybody says, you know, it'd be great to get back to family values, but what's interesting, very few people are talking about what those values actually are. And, you know, it's politically correct to believe in family values, but it's politically incorrect to get specific about what those values are or where those values come from. Here at the Point, our concern is not about political correctness. You know that if you've attended here very long. Our goal is to be biblically correct. And that's why we go to the Word of God to form the foundation of our teaching. We aren't teaching from pop culture. We're not teaching from the headlines. We're teaching from the Word of God and applying it to where we live today. And so the question, as we begin this brand new series called Family Values, what are values anyway? Well, values are those important and lasting beliefs or ideals that every one of us possess on some level or another. Important and lasting beliefs or ideals. They're those elements of our life that are vitally important to us. They're the things that form our core beliefs, which guide us to living the life that we want to live in meaningful and productive and satisfying ways. Values would be the standards that you measure your choices by, whether you do that consciously or unconsciously. Like a compass, these values provide direction and clarity for our lives. And we get our values from lots of different sources. You may share some values of the people around you. You've picked them up from family or friends or coworkers or colleagues, who knows, but we pick up values from the people around us. On a broader scale, you may pick up certain values by being a part of a certain social group or an ethnic group or maybe even a religious group like the church. You pick up values by those associations. I suppose certain values can be dictated to some extent by our personality. It would be safe to say that values emerge from a combination of background and experiences. Values emerge from a combination of background and experiences. Social media is undoubtedly helping shape the values of a new generation. There's no question about that. Certain values in our life may remain constant throughout our entire lifetime, while others evolve and kind of develop over the course of time. And I would tell you that changing values can be good, But on the same hand, changing values can be bad. Changing values are good when they represent growth and maturity. I was talking to somebody about that this week, how, you know, I see certain things a little bit differently today than I maybe saw them 10 or 20 or 30 years ago. That's good if that comes from personal growth, if it comes from personal maturity. But on the other hand, changing values are bad when they represent a deterioration or a deviation from God's standard. And that's why we continually keep coming back to the Word of God to form the foundation, the source of determining our values for us personally, as a family, and as households of any size. It's no secret that the media, you know, TV, music, books, literature, you know, all of that has been a major contributor and influencer of the values in American culture. Through the media, most of us have seen some really dramatic shifts taking place in regard to morality and ethics and values in contemporary families. I was thinking about some of the different American families, popular TV families that I'm aware of, and there's an obvious shift in values. For instance, and this predates me, I'll just tell you that right on the front end because I don't want you to think the wrong thing, but I was thinking one of the first TV families that I can remember, and it would have been reruns, it wasn't when it first came out, would have been Ozzie and Harriet Nelson. How many of you know who I'm talking about when I say Ozzie and Harriet? That's old school, man. I'm not kidding you. That was reruns at best when I was a kid. I mean, I know you were there when they made it. I understand. I'm sorry. You've got this culture then. This is back in black and white days, you know, one of the earliest families probably most would remember, you know, and their values were different. And then as you go through, I was thinking about some of the different ones like the Waltons. How many of you remember the Waltons or the Ingalls, somebody like that? Yeah, you got a few people that'll remember them. The Cosbys, anybody remember them? How about the Simpsons? I got to tell you, some of you, this is going to be disappointing. That is not based on a true story. That's not a real family. I mean, in case you were wondering. But and then we've got the modern family. So you go all the way from Ozzie and Harriet up to the modern family, you can see there's quite a dichotomy and quite a shift in values. And if we're going to talk about traditional family values, I think there would be some that would think, yeah, we need to go back to, you know, the Ozzie and Harriet days, or the, you know, the days of the Ingalls and Little House on the Prairie or the Waltons or something like that. Well, I want to tell you this morning, we need to go back way beyond that, because we need to go back to the very foundation, to the very beginning, because thousands of years ago, God gave 10 values for family living. We call them the 10 Commandments. And these are not values that are faddish. The beauty of it is these are not values that are influenced by culture. And they don't come and go, these values. These are lasting values, and they have stood the test of time. These values that we're going to talk about over these next few weeks, they literally do form the bedrock, the foundation of Western civilization. They form the foundation of our entire judicial and legal system. That's where it's all been built. And the Ten Commandments, they are commandments that come to us directly from God. We need to take them seriously. And so over these next few weeks, we're going to explore how these commandments can make a positive difference in your family and in your life. Deuteronomy chapter 6, these are the words of God to us. He said, "These commands that I give you today, they're to be upon your hearts." Verse 7, "Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up." See, when God gave these commands thousands of years ago, there were no expiration dates. It was given to us as a timeless instrument and a tool to utilize and to apply to our lives. He told us to remember these things, remember them ourselves, and he also said, teach them to our children. I thought it would be interesting. I'm not going to ask you to do it, but I would love to know how many people really know the Ten Commandments. I mean, a lot of people know them or think they know them, but a lot of surveys and things that I've read, you know, people would see the golden rule, do unto others as you'd have them do unto you, and they'd say, that's one of the Ten Commandments. No, it's not. They didn't even know the Ten Commandments. And then the question is, do your children know the Ten Commandments? How do we follow them if we don't know them? And the good news is, if your kids don't know them, we're going to be teaching them during these weeks in the Next Gen department. I hope you'll have your children in there if they're not there today. But we have a responsibility ourselves to teach them. about important things, about things they need to know to live a safe and productive life. And this is, you know, the Ten Commandments. It's something they need to know. It's kind of like teaching your child to not put their hand on a hot stove. You know, we've heard that, you know, you teach your child, don't ever do that. We don't want you to get burnt. We don't want you to get hurt. And so don't put your hand on a hot stove. Why do we teach them something like that? Because we love them. Because we care about them. Because we don't want them to be hurt. And so by the same token, we need to understand that God gave these commands not to hurt us, but to help us. They're for our own good. They're to protect us, not to punish us. These commandments that we're going to look at have a positive purpose in life. They're for our benefit. There's no question. And if you ignore them, if you ignore these commands that came to us from God, you do so at your own peril. You can make that choice, but it's not a wise choice. There's always a price to pay when you disregard God's command. You will suffer the consequences when you violate God's clear direction. And so today, we're going to discover the foundation to build a strong family. That's where we're going to start, is with the foundation. Our key text is going to be Exodus chapter 20. We're in the second book of the Old Testament where the Ten Commandments are given. And we're about to see these specific commands. They are not accidental. They're not random either. These commandments are in a specific order. I'm convinced that God intentionally put the first commandment first because it is fundamental and foundational to all the rest. Beginning at Exodus chapter 20, verses 1 and 2, God spoke all these words. It says, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. See, he's setting us up to bring us to commandment number 1, which is in Exodus chapter 20, verse 3, where he says, you shall have no other gods before me. That's straightforward and blunt and to the point, isn't it? You shall have no other gods before me. See, the Israelites had just come out of the land of Egypt. God had delivered them, and it was a land of many idols and many gods, and each god represented a different aspect of life. And so it was common for these Israelites to worship many gods in an attempt to get the maximum number of blessings. There were all these things in that culture where they had been, and so when God told his people to worship and believe in him only, that was, you know, or believe in him, that wasn't the hard part. Because they would just look at that and say, well, you know, I've got this God for this part of my life and this God for that part of my life and this God, and I'm believing in all these different gods and worshiping all these different gods because I want blessings here and there and everywhere. And so it's no problem to just add one more God to the mix. Why not? You know, it's a good thing to do. The problem came when he said, you shall have no other gods before me. You shall have no other gods except me. See, that was the difficult thing for people to take in or understand, because if you didn't learn to get God to the point where he's the one that led them out of Egypt, he is the one true God, if they didn't get to the point where they could trust him only, they couldn't be his people. No matter how faithfully they kept all the other 9 commandments, they had to focus on this commandment, no other gods. You could say it, God first, God alone. And so you might say, why does that even need to be spoken? I mean, isn't there only one God anyway? And we know that's true, there is. There's only one God, but there's a subtle distinction that I want you to see in our text here, because the word gods, as it's used here, it's written with a small g. Small g gods. He's not talking about the God with a capital G, the Almighty God, the Creator God. He's talking about small g gods. And a God could be anything that dominates or controls your life. A small g God could be anything that dominates or controls your life. Your God could be money. Your God could be some possession that you have. Your God could be fame or work or pleasure. It could be another person. Could even be golf, for all I know. The possibilities are really endless. But even good things that God created for us to enjoy, those things can become gods when you give them the place in your life that should rightly be occupied only by Almighty God, the Creator God, capital G. So we grasp for things that we hope are going to bring identity. We look for things that are going to bring security and meaning in life. And, you know, I don't think anybody really sets out with the intention of worshiping any of this stuff or any of these small g kinds of gods. But by the amount of time and energy we devote to them, what happens is they rapidly evolve or turn into small g gods. And one of the best ways to prevent that from happening is to make sure that the one true God holds the central place in your life. That's the best way to make sure that nobody else sits in that seat, is to make sure that God is on the throne of your life. That way there's no other room for other things or other people or stuff to creep in and turn into those little gods. Whenever anything or anyone takes the place that rightly belongs to God, that single decision, folks, will have devastating implications on every other facet of your life. And so what we're talking about here this morning, this really is a foundational principle to living. This is a foundational principle for life, and we dare not overlook it, because foundations, they are of absolute critical importance. Because whenever the foundation of a building is compromised, we know that the entire structure is in jeopardy. When you've got foundation problems, you have real problems. And what's true for a building, I would tell you this morning, is true for your life and mine. When we've got foundation problems, our whole life can be in jeopardy. And, you know, we all choose a foundation for our life, something that we're going to build on, something that will be the foundation and the core for our belief system. And, you know, what you're basing your life on is of such great importance. And foundations are crucial. And have you noticed that nobody admires the foundation of famous buildings? I mean, if you saw pictures of the White House this week, you didn't see anybody up there taking pictures of the foundation, say, man, that is, look at that foundation, that's awesome. Nobody does that. Nobody goes to the Chrysler Building or the Sears Tower or the Capitol Building and says, man, what an amazing foundation. Nobody talks like that. Nobody wants a picture of those things because the foundation is not glamorous. But in many ways, when you stop and think about it, the foundation is the absolute most important part of the structure. Think about that. Without a proper foundation, the structure is destined for destruction. If it's not solid, if it's not good, and we see this principle at work in our world today. See, marriages and families are crumbling and falling apart all around. And in many cases, that's because they have been built on the wrong foundation. You don't have to be in that number. See, it doesn't matter how much time, how much money, how much effort that you put into the structure. If it's not built on the right foundation, it's not gonna last. And some of you could stand and testify to that. See, to build on the right foundation means that I'm gonna put God first in my life. I'm gonna put God first in my family. That's one decision that you will never regret. Putting God first, keeping Him central, keeping Him on the throne of your life. See, often God gives us principles and then He connects those principles to a promise. That's what He did over in Proverbs chapter 3, verse 6. Take a look where it says, in everything you do, put God first, tying right back to this command, put God first, and He will direct you and crown your efforts with success. I just want to tell you this morning, however young or old you might be, single or married, but whatever your lot in life, putting God first, it is the wise thing to do. When we put Him first, He has promised to direct us and crown our efforts with success. So what we're going to do this morning is we're going to talk about some tangible ways that we can put God first. And we teach toward application here because we believe it's important for you to go away and not just say, hey, that's a nice truth. I don't know what difference it makes. I don't see how it applies to my life. We want you to be able to leave here and say, here's how that applies to my life. Here's what I'm going to do about that. And so I'm going to give you an acrostic spelling out the word first, F-I-R-S-T, and we're going to put down some tangible things that you can do starting today to put God first, some areas where you can put God first in your life. And by having it in the form of acrostic, maybe it'll help you remember a little bit more. And I'd seen these 5 points at some point along the way. They helped me, I hope they'll help you. And we're gonna start with what for many is the most difficult place for them to put God first, and that is letter F, their finances. Now some of you are like, oh man, I knew it, here we go again. Put God first in your finances. Look at Proverbs chapter 3, verse 9. It says, honor the Lord by giving him the first part of all your income, and he will fill your barns with wheat and barley and overflow your wine vats with the finest wines. God has said that money is the number one test of our priorities. You can't get around it. We spend so much of our lives dealing with money, and it literally does. It affects every single one of us every day. We spend so much time of our lives earning it, saving it, spending it, giving it, investing it. And you can't, you can't get around it. And I would tell you that you find out what's important to a person, not by what they speak, but by what they spend. That's the truth. You find out what's important to a person, not by the words that they speak, but by what they spend. For instance, if I'm not going to ask you to do it, but what if we were to say, hey, let's get everybody here to take out what in the olden days we would have said would be your check register, or today would be your bank statement or your credit card statement or your debit card statement or whatever. Whatever record you have, maybe it's an Excel spreadsheet or an app on your phone, I don't know. But what if we were to take whatever represents your spending habits, and I was going to ask you to pass those down to somebody on your right or to your left and just let them take a look at your spending habits and just see where have you been spending your money. What would that exercise reveal about the priorities in your life? I mean, if somebody could look at every bit of money that you've spent over the last 60, 90 days, maybe the last year, they saw where your spending priorities had come from, what would that tell them about the priorities in your life? See, by simply looking at how you spend your money, a person who has never met you, who doesn't even know your name, doesn't know anything about you, they would be able to tell a lot about your life, wouldn't they? And maybe, just maybe, maybe that's why you don't want them to see it. Possibly, because it tells a lot. It tells the truth about who we are. We can find out a lot about what's first in our lives by the way we spend. Deuteronomy chapter 14, verse 23, it says, now look at this, the purpose. Why do we tithe? What's the big deal about that? Why does he talk about it? The purpose of tithing is to teach you always to put God first in your lives. See, the tithe by definition is 10%. God says the first 10% of what you make, it's back to me. And the purpose of the tithe, as it tells us right here in Deuteronomy, is simply to teach us to put God first. And I don't know how to make it any clearer or give any simpler advice as a pastor that, you know, than to tell you that if you're in a financial mess right now, one step to put your house in order financially is to put God first in your finances. If he's not first, and I know some would argue with this and say, yeah, I want to talk about it, let me explain. The truth of the matter is, in all likelihood, and I've watched this for over 30 years, if he's not first in your finances, he's probably not first in your life. You can say, hey, that's not true, whatever, but I would ask you to go back and just look at the record yourself, on your own, and say, God, show me, what is my spending habits? What does this prove about what's important to me? See, when I set aside the first 10% of my income and I give it on the first day of the week, I am revealing what is truly important in my life. Tithing is an act of worship. You may give generously to all kinds of other charities and worthy causes, but that's not tithing. Tithing is an act of worship that is done as a priority at my place of worship. Finances is the first place to put God first. And by the way, today, Financial Peace University, Jeff and Michelle, firing it up 4:00 this afternoon. If you haven't signed up, there's still time. Second place we put God first is in our interests. That should be plural, I noticed after I wrote it, but F-I-R-S-T, first, the letter I is interests. If God's really going to be number one, you need to put him first in your interests. That means put him first in your fun times, your play times, your pastimes, your amusements, your recreations, your hobbies, all of that. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31, so whether you eat or drink, whatever you do, get it? Whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. And if you can't do it for the glory of God, you might as well not do it, right? Whatever you do, do it for the glory of God. How do you do that? You do it by putting God first in what you do. You can tell a lot, again, about a person's priorities by seeing what they get excited about. Where do they spend their time? You know, what's important to you? What do you like to talk about the most? I know people who can talk for hours on end about their kids, about sports, about hobbies, about all kinds of things, but they can't seem to talk about the Lord for 2 minutes. If God is first in your life, you're going to make him a part of your conversation. You won't be ashamed to talk about him because he's number one. That's a tangible way to put God first in your life in the area of our interests. Letter R would be relationships. This is another place where we can put God first. If you want God to be first, you're going to have to choose your friends carefully. Proverbs chapter 27, verse 19, it says, "A mirror reflects a man's face, but what he is really like is shown by the kinds of friends he chooses." Somebody says, "Well, what do my friends have to do with God being first in my life?" It has to do with the fact that you become like the people you hang around with. Have you noticed that? You can tell that to your kids when they're little, but it's true for adults as well. You become like the people you hang around with. If you spend time with people who take God lightly, who take God's name in vain, you'll tend to become a casual believer. But if you spend time with people who are committed, who take God at his word, it's more likely you're going to become a more strong, a more committed Christian. And that's not to say you shouldn't have unbelievers as friends. That's not to say that at all. It is to say you need to be careful. Proverbs 12:26 says, "A righteous man is cautious in friendship." It's a great line. A righteous man, a righteous woman, a righteous teenager is cautious in friendship. The truth is, if you really want God first in your life, there are some relationships that you need to avoid. There are some relationships that you need to steer clear of, that you need to put behind you. They're dead wrong, and you probably know that, so don't make any excuses for it. Choose your friends wisely and carefully. Put God first in your relationships. Next thing, letter S, schedule. Put him first in your schedule. This is, of course, about our time, which is our most precious commodity. Ephesians chapter 5, this is out of the Phillips translation, which I love the way it states this. "Make the best use of your time. Grasp firmly what you know to be the will of God." What great counsel for us today. Make the best use of your time. Grasp firmly what you know to be the will of God. I put God first in my schedule by asking him to help me use my time wisely. God, what do you want me to do today with my time? I've only got so much time. How do you want me to invest my time? And if you find yourself constantly having more to do than you have time to do, it could be that you're doing some things that are not God's will for you. Maybe good things, but it's just not the things he has for you. I had a wise pastor friend tell me one time, he said, "Steve, if you think that you need to be in two places at one time, one of them is not an obligation." That's pretty good counsel, don't you think? If you're supposed to be in two places at once, and some of us feel that way every once in a while, one of those places is not an obligation. Whenever I start feeling frustrated and hassled and frazzled, it's often because I'm trying to do more than God wants me to do. And when I'm going to get down to putting God first in my life or family, I need to set aside time in my schedule to be with him. And people get all hung up on, when do you do it? How long do you do it? And what part of the day do you do it? It doesn't matter. It just matters that you do it. You need to do it. Even if it's only 10 or 15 minutes, set aside some time to talk to God, but not only talk to God, also listen to God as God talks to you. We can get so busy that God just gets shoved completely out of our lives. It's what Jeremiah was talking about when he said, "My people have forgotten me for days on end." I don't want to be in that number, forgetting God for days on end. I don't want you to be in that number, to forget God for days on end. One way to avoid that possibility is by making time to be with him on your own. Like we would call that a devotional time where you set it aside every day. I would encourage you to make time to pray together. I was talking to some folks about that just the other day, about how important it is to pray together as a couple. It's important to pray together as a family. Praying before meals, I think, is a great practice. It reminds us that God is the source of all of our blessings, including the food we eat. And, we're going to set aside some time. It's a built-in reminder to help us to spend time with God every day. We're going to say, "God, you're more important than us racing into this meal." We're going to acknowledge you as our source, and we're going to thank you for what you've done for us. When we pause to pray before we eat, we're modeling an important priority before our children, to let them know that God is first and that he's a priority in our life. Letter T, the last one. Somebody get excited. Say amen. Troubles. It's our last one. Troubles, the letter T. When you face unexpected problems and pressures, when you have a crisis, God wants you to turn to him. Far too many people, for far too many, prayer is the last resort when it ought to be our first choice. I've heard people say things like, you know, I guess now all we can do is pray. I mean, it's just kind of like, well, you know, it's last resort. It kind of seems hopeless, but I guess all we can do now is pray. Well, folks, prayer should not be the last resort for a dedicated follower of Christ in crisis. That should be our first response. God says he is an ever-present help. He is a refuge in our time of need. He is our source of strength and hope in our time of trouble. Psalm chapter 50, verse 15 tells us, God, to call upon me. This is what God says, call on me in the day of trouble. I will deliver you and you will honor me. Some people get embarrassed, say, well, I don't know if I can call on God when times, you know, are rough because I don't call on God enough when times are good. No loving parent would ever feel that way about their kids. And I want to tell you, God does not feel that way, I don't think, about his kids. He wants us to call on him. And one of the easiest ways to tell if you're not putting God first in your life is you get worried about every little thing. Worry is the warning light that God is not first in my life, at least not in that particular moment. Because when I start worrying, it says I'm going to play God. I'm assuming responsibility that he did not intend for me to bear. And when God's not first, that's the response. I begin to worry. I get all stressed out, worry, you know, when he's not first in my finances, I begin to worry about my finances. You know, when he's not first in my relationships, that's when I start to worry about those relationships. When God's not first in my schedule, I start to worry about my schedule. When he's not first in, you know, my problems and my trials and my troubles, I worry about them. It's about putting God first in every one of these areas. Now, I want to ask you a question. I want you to just stop and pause this morning and do a little heart check and ask yourself a question. I don't want anybody raising your hands. I'm not trying to press anything like that, but I want you to be honest with yourself before God. Can you say, in all honesty, that God is first in every area of your life? Is God first, is God central in my life today? That's the question I want you to think about. Is God first in my life completely on every level in every area today? Here's the thing. You can only build a strong family as you build on the right foundation. That can only happen as we honor this first commandment and put God first. Make sure he's first. Make sure he's first in your finances. Make sure he's first in your interest. Make sure that he's first in your relationships. Make sure that he's first in your schedule, and make sure that he's first in your troubles. Do you think the world would be a better place if more people would put God first? I mean, if more people would put God at the center of their lives, I think it would change our world. I think it would be initiation to bringing healing in our land, and our land needs healing. I think we're all aware of that today. And so I'd like for us to close in prayer before we close in song by praying for God to bring healing and to help us individually and collectively to make a decision, a wise decision, to put God at the center of our heart, of our lives, of our family, of our homes. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, I thank you for your presence with us this day. I thank you for your word and for these commandments that speak to every one of us about important values, about the living of life. And here we begin with this first one, this very foundational principle, to put God first, to put God at the center of our home, our life, our family. Lord, today, I pray that if you're not at that central place in somebody's life, that they will make a decision and they will make it a priority to put you first. We believe that that can make a difference in homes across the land. We believe it can make the difference in the lives of individual people. And we believe that it can make a difference in our nation. We believe it can make a difference in our world. And so today, Lord, we pray for revival. We pray for renewal. We pray for a fresh touch from you, for your spirit to impact our lives and enable us to make decisions we'll be glad we made for all eternity. And for what's accomplished, we'll give you praise in Jesus' name.